Hi, and welcome to another installment of the Electronics and Programming Beginner's Guide. My name is Igor Vinograd, and I decided to shoot an impromptu video of designing a quick board in Eagle. Like I said, this is an impromptu video. This is not a tutorial, but I will kind of comment as I'm designing things and walk through some design things in Eagle. So let's get started. By the way, I will be posting the files that I generate here on my website at eapbg.com, and I will also post the design rule check file and the zoom unrouted file as well. So without further ado, let's get started. So first we are going to create a new project. So new project, and this is going to be the CAN Terminator. Like so. What the project actually does is irrelevant for the video, but what this project is going to be is a board that terminates a CAN bus. So once we have a new project, let's create a new schematic like that. And the schematic isn't saved automatically, so we want to save it. And this is going to be the CAN Terminator. Go ahead and save that. So the very first thing I always do whenever I start a schematic is add a frame. So first we go to our parts library, which is this icon right here, add. And both capturing the video and running Eagle at the same time is a tad taxing on my computer. This isn't state of the art by any way, shape, or form. So I apologize if there is some lag in loading stuff. There we go. All right, so to add a frame, we real quick, the all of the libraries in Eagle are incredibly confusing. It took me the longest time to even begin to figure them out. So don't be intimidated by these. You always have to start somewhere. So this is a good place to start. So we're looking for frames. Frames, frames, frames. There they are. And we're gonna grab the A3L frame. For me, this is the frame that I like to work with most often. And you hit OK, don't hit drop. Drop will actually remove the library from Eagle. So we want to put the frame down, and I always like to put it down at the origin, like that. Now, Eagle has persistent tools, meaning once you use them, you will continue to use them until you either switch tools or hit the stop right here. So after we place the frame, we want to hit escape, and we want to place a connector. The connector comes from one of my own personal libraries, which the library actually came from our team. I'm on a robotics team. And we like to use these connectors, and one of the previous members has put this connector together, and it is a Euromag 4. And we want this one right here. Eagle shows you, the other CAD programs do too, but they show you a schematic symbol. They show you the package that the symbol represents. And the thing I really like is in the package, it gives you a little dimension symbol so you can usually gauge how large the part is in the case that you're looking for parts. So let's go ahead and place this connector. So to navigate in Eagle, The scroll wheel scrolling out zooms you out, scrolling in zooms you in, and if you push and hold the scroll wheel, it lets you pan around. So let's place a connector. So after we place the connector, we hit escape to come back into the libraries, and let's go ahead and close this library. And now we want to place some resistors. And Eagle has this library, comes with Eagle. It's the RCL, the resistor, capacitor, and inductors library. And in that, we want to go to RUS, which is American resistor symbols, and we're looking for RUSM0805. 0805 is a type of surface mount package for resistors. So now we're going to zoom in a little more, and we want to place some resistors. If you want to rotate the resistors, you or any part as you place it, you right click and it'll rotate. So we want to go 1, 2, 3, 4, and we need a fifth one up here, like that. Okay, hit escape to come back into the library, and now we want to place two capacitors. So CUS, and same thing, we're looking for 0805 packages, and they're probably right in front of it. Nope, here they are, 0805, right there. So hit OK. And we want a capacitor here, and we want a capacitor up here, like that. Hit escape to come back into the library. Go ahead and close those. Now we want to place some ground symbols, and those are found in the supply library right here. The supply one, supply two libraries are the most commonly used libraries because they have all of your voltage symbols and all your ground symbols, and so forth. And we want to place a ground here. We want to place a ground here, and we want to place a ground here. Okay. Oop, went too far. Let me open that back up. Now, finally, I think finally, we want to place a LED symbol. And I'm going to do that out of the Adafruit library. The Adafruit library does not come with Eagle, but it can be downloaded. You can find it on adafruit.com. Great library, lots of parts in it. Adafruit uses Eagle to design their boards. So they provide all of their Eagle libraries, and so does SparkFun. You can also download their Eagle libraries, which we will use a SparkFun part a little bit later. Let's see here. We want to use an LED from their library. I really like. There we go. I really like. It's a similar to the other parts. It's an 0805 chip LED. I really like this LED because it has this plus sign right here, which makes it a great indicator for orientation. If you compare it to, say, even this symbol, there's no plus sign on it. So we go back to this guy and hit OK, and we're going to place this LED right here. Okay, so now that we have all of our parts, and you don't have to put them down in this particular order like I did. I just did the I knew what parts I needed ahead of time. Now we're going to connect them all together. And to connect them, you would think you use the wire tool, but you would be wrong. And I made the same mistake when I was starting out. The wire tool is more of a line tool. The thing to actually connect parts together is the net tool. So we're going to use the net tool to connect all of our parts together. Like that, and we can use the move tool to move them around to make it look a little nicer. Go back to the net tool. I want to make this net bend in a different direction. So if I right click, you can see up at the top bar the selected bend will change like that. So same thing, let's change the bend up here like that. Like that. And we're about connected like that. So in Eagle, and this is a little quirky, first let me move this guy out of the way because he can stay down here. To move a group of components, first you have to grab the group tool and highlight the components that you want to move. Then you want to select the move tool if it's not already selected, and you can't just click and grab the parts to move them. You have to right click and go move group. And it's that move group that allows you to move the parts together. Let me show you. If I highlight the parts and without going to move group, just try and grab something. First of all, it won't grab. And second of all, it'll just grab if I click on a part, it'll grab just that part. So I'm going to grab the net tool and go ahead and connect that up. So now we have our schematic all laid out. Next, we need to do the names and the values. So let's do the names, and we want to name this LED something other than just LED1. So we grab the name tool right here. We click on the LED and then we can rename it, and we want to rename it Power, because this LED will let us know that the board is powered correctly. Like that. And that's really the only other name we need to change, because the part numbers are automatically incremented as you place them. So next we want to do some values. So for the values, you click on the part and now you want to label it. So we want to go, this resistor needs to be 1K ohms, and it's a resistor, so the ohms is kind of implied, and we always want to specify what tolerance level we want. So 5% is a pretty standard value for a resistor. The reason for this is if somebody else is assembling your board, they can look at this value and they can know exactly what you wanted. So at least you want a 5% tolerance on this resistor. The biggest reason why we specified this is resistor R1 and R2 need to be 60 ohm resistors, and instead of ohm, I like to put R, but these need to be higher precision. They need to be 1%. And so the person assembling the board knows that they need to be, these specifically need to be 1%. They are labeled. Let's go ahead and label that one. Okay. The value for R3 and R4 are still undecided. So for the time being, I'm going to leave them blank. Now let's focus on the LED. For the LED, we want to give it a value. And that value is going to be green. And that sounds like a strange value, but similar to how the resistors have a tolerance on them, the green lets an assembler, somebody on your team, or even you know what color LED they meant to put there. So now let's go to the capacitors. And for the capacitors, this is a 0.1, not 0.1 U farad capacitor. And you always want to label the kind of capacitor you want to put there. This is a ceramic. And there are tantalums and some other ones, but it's again for the assembler, you want to give them enough information and you want to label your minimum voltage because whenever you're using a bunch of different capacitors on a board, this actually becomes very important. So 6.3 volts is a fairly standard voltage for a capacitor. And so you'll learn what the different voltages are, etc., over time. But okay, we want to add that. And this capacitor is the same. So we want to actually, another way to do this is if you right click on a component, you can go to value or any other things, or you can go to properties. But in properties, you cannot change the value, it will complain at you. So let's go right click and value. And same thing, this is a not, oops, not 0.1 U farad ceramic 6.3 volt capacitor. Okay, so now we have all of our capacitors and resistors labeled. Let's generate our board file. So to generate a board file from the schematic, we click on this icon right here, and it's generate and switch to board. And it'll ask us, do we want to create this because it doesn't exist? And yes, we do. So now you can see that the board file and the schematic file are open at the same time. And this is very important whenever you're doing any kind of editing in Eagle on your files. You want to have both of these schematics open at the same time. So now let's go ahead and maximize this. And the black outline is your board dimensions, and we'll worry about the board dimensions later. Oh, now that I think about it, I did forget something. To switch back to the schematic view, we can hit the switch to schematic. And what I forgot were the mounting holes that this board needs. Let's go ahead and close those up. The library is holes, and we want pad round two like that, and just place these into the schematic. And we can hit stop to deselect the tool that we're using, and we can switch back to the board view. And if you have a keen eye, you can see that these were added because we added them into the schematic. So now we have the board file and the navigation in the board editor is the same. You use the scroll wheel to zoom in and out, and if you push on the scroll wheel, it lets you pan around. And when Eagle first loads the board file, all of your parts are off to one side, and you have a standard board layout. So the first thing that we want to do is we want to turn off viewing the part value. And to do this, you go to the layer settings and you scroll down and you want to deselect T values and B values and hit apply and okay. And you can see all the values disappeared. This makes the look a little cleaner. So let's zoom in on here. To work with any parts in the board editor, every single part has a black, plus sign, if you want to call it that, or a black crosshair on it. This is the origin of the part. You have to grab the origin of the part to move it around or to do anything. All of the actions always work on the origin. If you don't click on the origin, there's no guarantee that you'll select the part, the correct part, or select the part at all. So we want to grab the move tool, and like I said, if I click here, the move tool doesn't do anything. But if I click on the origin, or at least near the origin, now I can select this part and move it around. And similar to the schematic, if you right click, the part gets rotated. So we want to rotate the part and place it in our schematic. I always like to place the larger parts first and then place the smaller parts. This is where a lot of this is where design decisions are really made is that you have to figure out where you want to place your components to get the best possible layout. And we want this guy about here. So now we want to grab our resistors, to help us better place them, we need to make the grid a little bit smaller, because if you notice, you can't just place the components wherever. Grab R1 and R2. You can't just place the components wherever you want. They go onto a grid. And by making the grid smaller, we can place the components better, make them align better, make the whole thing generally look nicer and neater. So now that we have these two resistors placed, let's place the capacitor. Which is this guy right here. And we want to turn it around. These yellow lines that connect everything, and actually, this is a good time to mention these yellow lines that connect everything are called air wires. And the air wire represents a trace that has not yet been routed. So, to first, you place your parts. Let's go like that. Then you route your traces between them. And there's no particular order that you have to do these in. That. Like that. I like to lay out little sections and then connect them up. So now that we have our resistors placed, let's route. To route, you use the route tool and the rip up tool. The route tool places down a trace. So these are the settings for the traces. We want to make our vias around, and we want to start on the top layer. And now we grab the trace, and similar to the schematic, by right clicking, you can change the angles of the traces, and we lay down a trace. Whenever you hear that ding, that means a trace was connected successfully to its endpoint. And when routing, it's generally recommended to use traces that are 45 degree angles, like that. And we want to make these nice and symmetrical, or at least try to make them nice and symmetrical. So if you want to pull up a trace, you use the rip up tool, and if you click on the air wire itself, you can remove the entire trace. There we go. That looks nice and symmetrical. Now we can connect these two. We can connect you two right there. If you hit escape, you can exit out of routing a trace like that. Go back here, route from this side, those two, that guy, like that. There we go. That kind of sets up our first section, which we can actually clean this up a little bit more by grabbing the capacitor and getting it a little closer. And same thing with the resistors. Grab the resistors and bring them a little closer, like that. And then we can grab the trace and go ahead and fix that, make it look nice. So we can actually shrink this section down even a little more. So what I like to do is I want to rip up this trace. And like I said, if you click on the yellow line, it unroutes everything. Now I want to grab the smash tool. So what the smash tool does is when I click on this part, watch this name designator very closely. It'll act, an origin will appear whenever I click the part. There it is. See this origin that popped up? Now I can use the move tool to actually move the designator without moving the part itself. But now whenever I move the part, the designator will move with it. And now we can slide these two resistors even closer to make this design as compact as possible. Like that. So now we can grab the route tool again. And there we go. We have a very nice looking layout. So every time you complete a little section, it's suggested that you run the design rule check, the DRC. So if you look down here, this is the DRC. Go ahead and open that up. There's a bunch of rules up here that you can change, but we have a file, this file right here, which has a set of PCB rules for OSH Park, and I will show you after we're done with this board. We'll upload this board and take a look at it in OSH Park's website. So to once the file is loaded, it shows up here and you hit check. So nothing popped up here, and if you look down here, it says DRC no errors. That means that no errors were found in the design. If an error is found, a little window opens up and it'll point to all of the errors that were found. So now that we have this little section laid out, we want to, oops, hold on, let me hit escape. See, Eagle's tools are persistent, so I still have the route tool selected, so now I'm going to grab the move tool instead of the route tool. That's why the trace started routing over there. Now I want to grab the power LED and go ahead and place it on the board. Now place its appropriate resistor like that. Go ahead and slide this guy in a little closer. The orientation of that guy is fine. And now we want to grab the capacitor and see where is a good place to put it. I apologize if this video is kind of boring. So the design work is not always glamorous, but it does lend itself to some good information. So something that I want to modify about this LED is I want to use the smash tool on it, like that. So you saw the origin pop up for the power label, and I want to move the power label. So I can better place this LED like that. And now I want to figure out a better place for this capacitor. I think right there would be fine, but just to double check, let's run the DRC again. So you always want to do a little section and then run the DRC. And excellent, everything passed. So now that we ran the DRC and it passed, now we want to commence wiring up our schematic. And actually, I'm looking at it, and there's something that I want to change around, possibly. Actually, no, this works out quite nicely. So to route this, first, that's a good place for that. Let's use the smash tool on that because the designator ends up kind of in the funky spot. Bring that guy out here. So now to route this, we said it's recommended to use 45 degree traces. We can go ahead and route this guy. Bring that trace over here, bring this over here. It's not going to be super pretty. I entirely understand that. Bring this trace over here like that. Connect the LED to the resistor and route the final. Power wire here, like that. So now let's run the DRC again. Check, and we pass, which is excellent. So now I'm going to demonstrate something, I'm going to demonstrate a couple of things. The first thing is we still have an air wire left here, and that's fairly easy to see because this is a small layout, but when your board is actually this big, trying to find that unrouted air wire is very difficult. So we're going to use a script. And to run a script, you type in run up here and hit enter, and it'll open you all of the available Eagle scripts. And this is a script that I found online. I didn't write it. It's called Zoom Unrouted. And when you open it, it will run and it'll zoom you in onto the unrouted airwire. So let's route this airwire. There's no really good way to get to the ground pin from this airwire while on the top of the board. So we're going to use the bottom of the board. And to do this, you select the route tool. You select round vias. For some reason, it always defaults to square. Not entirely sure why. So now you can select the trace, click, which brings the trace out to here, and now you change your layer. So now we want to go to the bottom, like that. And did you see that as soon as I laid down the bottom trace, Eagle automatically inserted the via right there. And now we want to connect this up to the ground pin. Like that. So this finishes the routing for this finishes the basic routing for the board. And now that I think about it, something I want to change is I actually want to move this designator a little bit over this way. And rotate it. And why I do that will be apparent in just a second. There we go. So now if I go to run, and I run that same script, you can see down here it will say run zoom unrouted finished, and I didn't zoom into the board. That means that all of my traces have been completely routed. There, meaning there are no air wires left. So now I want to change the board dimensions. 7, 9. So I want to zoom out and I can grab the info tool and click on this edge and I want to change the dimensions. These are the dimensions and I want to go 0.79, 0.79. I got these dimensions by looking at the XY coordinates of the edge of that connector. So now that I did that, this trace is kind of close to the edge. So what I want to do is I want to run the DRC again, just in case. And it passes, perfect. So now I want to kind of judge the edge of this, which what I could do is actually move this in and down a little bit, like that. And this edge is, I don't know, 1.16 inches, 1.15. So go ahead and grab the info tool, click on that, and go 1.15, 1.15, okay. Zoom in on you and again run the DRC to be sure. So now our board is generally laid out. So some other things that we want to do for this board is we want to do a ground pour. So to do a ground pour, you grab the polygon tool. And we're going to do the bottom layer first. We want to do square corners on this guy. So we're going to lay it out this way. And you want the polygon to complete like that. And boom, the polygon is complete. And now we want to go to the info tool, select. We want to go to the name tool. We want to select the polygon. And we want to call this polygon G and D. By calling this the name of this polygon G and D, it will connect to the ground plane. And click OK. And now we want to grab the polygon tool again. Select the top layer and do exactly the same thing. Like that and like that. And grab the name tool and select the polygon. And call it G and D. And hit OK. So, real quick, quirky thing about Eagle, you have two parts that are right on top of each other, which are the polygons. So, when you left click on the polygons the first time, it highlights the red polygon, but the info. The name doesn't appear right away because Eagle is not sure which polygon you want. Do you want the red top layer or do you want the blue bottom layer? So in case I want the red top layer, I would just go ahead and left click again. But in case I want the blue layer, I would right click and now the blue layer is selected and now I would left click to verify that I do want that. So now we hit rat's nest. What rat's nest does is normally, it will rearrange the air wire so it'll show you the shortest paths to all of your connections. But in this case, the schematic was very, very simple. We really didn't have to rat's nest it up until now. Now, when we rat's nest it, the polygon will fill in the ground pores. So now we go ahead and rat's nest, and bam, here are our ground pores. So a couple of things that we want to do now that we have the ground pores. There's only two places that the ground pores are tied together, and that's the ground pin here and the via here. So we want to throw in a few more vias to stitch the ground together a little better. So we already have a via right here that's grounded, so we want to use the copy tool to go ahead and copy it. And go ahead and place a few more vias. So to make this placement a little easier, I want to change the grid again. Like that. Oh, maybe not. Let's change the grid back. Via, via. the here. Just kind of do some general via stitching, it's referred to. Via stitching actually reduces the inductance of the board. That. I don't want one there. Let's put another one here. And another one here. Something that you have to be careful with when using vias, you don't want too many vias because some board manufacturers actually have a limit of how many vias you can have per square inch. So now that we have some vias down, we want to go ahead and run the DRC again. Always want to run the DRC. And we passed. To add symbols, symbols are located in the parts library. We want to go to the SparkFun library. Aesthetics. Or was it? This is the open source hardware logo. Like that. And as I mentioned previously, I will post the board and Gerber files for this board on my website, eapbg.com. So after that, we want to add some labels. And labels are, for some reason, labels are very underestimated. So first, I want to put my name on the board. If you're looking at the label right now is on the wrong layer. It's on the top copper layer. So what you want to do is you want to move it down to the top name layer. Like that, and you can see changed color. Now we want to change the size. It's a little too small. We might have to play around with some spacing to get things to fit. Like that. And we'll fix up the spacing here in a little bit. Like that, right? And as I mentioned before, you want to hit stop to just outright stop using the tool that you had before. Let's grab this open hardware symbol and slide it over. Give us a little more space. Like that. And our can. Labels like that and like that ground. The reason why I moved the symbol, the capacitor symbol, was so I have room to put this ground indicator in there. And we're just about complete. You always want to save. And I did actually put a boo-boo on this board, and I will show you what I actually did and what is wrong with it here in just a second. So now that the board is all put together, we have all of our labels on it and everything. What I like to do is go to OSH Park's website. They are a board manufacturer and a good one for that matter. Most likely our team will get this board from them. So this is the homepage. You go to get started and you want to select a file on your computer. So I'm already in the CAN Terminator folder or from Eagle, and there is a BRD file, and we want to grab that BRD file. But you always want to grab it after you save, because you can grab it before you save and it doesn't come out correctly. So we want to go ahead and start uploading that file, and it takes a minute to process. And you gotta type in your email. And then it will automatically name your project. You can always change the name if you want and add a description. And this will also tell you how much the board will cost, because OSH Park uses a $5 per square inch setup, so it will measure your board and then tell you exactly how much it will cost. So the processing takes a minute because OSH Park is actually generating the Gerbers for the file on their servers, but what's nice is it takes the need for you to generate the the Gerbers, because Gerber generation can sometimes be confusing, especially for beginners, etc. And now we wait. Hurry up and wait, right? Which it looks like it's being extra slow today. Any minute now. Come on, any minute now. I think after I show you the Osage Park rendering of this, I will go ahead and generate the Gerbers as well. So I have a job file already set up to do Gerbers, so I can run them off real quick and set it. Whenever I post the files for both this board, I will also post the Gerbers and the job file and the DRC and the Zoom unrouted. There we go. As I said, it auto-named it, which is fine. You can rename it. It doesn't particularly matter. So what this shows you is that it detected a two-layer board. It gives you the dimensions of the board, and then it tells you how much the board costs. So for three copies of this board, it would be $4.50. And then it gives you a general preview of the board. So after you hit continue, it will show you some detailed previews of the board. So, can you guys already spot the whoopsie that I induced into this? So this is the bottom of the board. I'm sorry, this is the top of the board. This is the bottom of the board. Then it actually shows you these are full renderings of what the board would look like. So, after that, it shows you your individual layers. So, top layer, bottom layer, solder mask, top and bottom. Your drills, your board outline, and then your silk screen. So the whoopsie that I induced is see this 5-volt marker right here. It's actually sitting right on top of a via, which is obscuring the label. So to everywhere else, I was very careful not to put vias and labels on top of each other, which this is essentially just a single layer a single-sided board, so it's not that difficult. But whenever boards become more complicated and you have a double-sided board with parts on both sides. Getting all of your labels correct sometimes is a bigger hassle than anything else because you have to worry about both sides. And this is why I like Osage Park's setup, because I can go in and look at a rendering of the board, so I can both top and bottom, so I can see little mistakes like this. So let's go back to Eagle and fix this. Grab the via and slide it over. Slide it over here. And then grab the label and slide it over this way a little bit. And just for good measure, because we moved the via, we want to run the DRC again. And it passed. Excellent. So go ahead and save it. And you can always re-upload this file to Osage Park, which if you go down here, you just hit start over and re-upload the file. But we don't have that kind of time. So what we're going to do is we're going to generate the Gerber files for these. The Gerber files are the files that you would normally give to a manufacturer to actually produce your board. So to run the Gerber files, you go to CAM processor. For the CAM processor, then you go file, open job, and select your job. So if I remember correctly, it is this job right here. And we'll see what the job looks like when we get there. That's looking correct. So the tabs up top here show you your different Gerbers that will be generated. So then it'll show you the top layer, the Gerbers in the RS 274X format. The file name will be top layer dot top layer dot GTL. The top layer part helps identifying which layer is which, and it will include the top layer, the pads, the vias. So then the bottom layer, same kind of thing, will include the bottom pads and vias. Where this got me last time, and I have fixed it since, was that the top silkscreen layer only included T-place. T-place is where you put the outlines for your components, so you know where certain components go in what orientation, but it did not include T names. So I actually made a set of boards that only have the placement markers, but none of the component name markers are there. But so I went ahead and fixed this, and same thing on the bottom silkscreen, I went ahead and added that. So then there's the top solder mask, the bottom solder mask, the board outline, and that's the black line around the board, and the Exelon drill files are all included in this job. So then you hit process job, and there you go, the Gerbers were created. Go ahead and close out of that, and now I can actually go and take a quick peek at the Gerbers. So now all of these files right here are the Gerbers. I'm actually not entirely sure what these GPI files are or where they're generated from, but like the GTO and GTS and GBS are the Gerber files.
As I mentioned previously, this video is not meant to be a tutorial. This was just me capturing my process and kind of narrating it as I developed a circuit board. So this was a very simple circuit board. So if you have any questions or you'd like to comment on the video, please comment at YouTube or my website, eapbg.com. So as I also mentioned previously, I will post the Gerber files and Eagle files for this board, and also I'll paste post the three helpful Eagle files, which was the Zoom unrouted, the design rule check for OSH Park, and the CAM process job, which lets you generate the Gerber files in the first place. So, like I said, please visit my website, eapbg.com, and you'll find the files there, etc. And please comment on this post or any of my other posts, both on YouTube and my website. Thank you for watching.